For those of you who don't know me, my name's Tom. I'm one of the owners and the manager of the bookstore. This is our sixth, I believe, Sunday morning civics, and we'll do at least a couple more. I haven't nailed down next Sundays yet, but if, you know, we have 2 feet of snow, then who knows? I just can't even get over that forecast. So, some of these have had a small group of people. Some of them have a very large group of people. All of them have been useful, I hope. Yes. And if you've enjoyed them, tell others to come. Yeah. Thank you. I know some people have been here for all of them. Yeah. So. Last week we were talking about what the city can do versus what the state can do and education, and I have to say almost everything out of Chris Dwyer's mouth was something I didn't know. And it really helps to be involved if you have some idea of how things actually work. Housing, already in the 5 minutes that we've been talking, I've learned a bunch of things that I didn't know. I'm a fairly new resident. I've been here since 2002, so like 15 years. I was on Art Speak very early on, where we were working very hard to find housing for artists. I have seen developments in my neighborhood that were not built, and are now being built 15 years later because of a very strong opponent from abutters. So there's so many pieces on the spectrum of on one end rules and regulations and zoning and economics, and on the other end the personality and character of our city and who gets to decide that and such. So today we have Nancy Colbert-Puff, who's the deputy city manager. She's escaped across the river. Was it last year? How long has it been?
Last May. Yeah.
Last May?
Yeah,
because you don't really show up on the city manager website.
Right, which
city manager page. Yeah. So it's sort of a stealth position. This is the time for a coup. Like, it's a John Bahankel. And then Rebecca Perkins, who's on city council. And I believe you said the other week ran specifically because of housing issues. So Rebecca's going to give us a little overview. And there's a nice small group of us, so I'm sure we can get all of our questions answered. Mm-hmm. Last thing I wanted to say, Wednesday night, author Roger Eckert will be here. The book is called American Sanctuary. It's nonfiction about a huge scandal during the John Adams administration, when there was a mutiny on a British ship in Puerto Rico, and one of the people came to the U.S. And was Adams agreed to extradite him, and he was hanged. And Jefferson, back then, I don't know if you know this, it's one of my favorite things, the person with the most votes was president, and the person with the second most was vice president. Chaos! I know! except that the person with the second most votes was generally of the other party. So, Jefferson seized on it. So, great, fascinating history, political intrigue, you name it, Wednesday night at 6:30. So, join us for that. All right. All you.
Okay. I guess I'll start and you can fill in. And good to see you. I don't know.
Eric said.
Hi, guys. Welcome. Thanks for making it out on Sunday morning. And we're here to talk about housing, and I'd much rather spend the time talking about housing in a way that's interesting to you guys. So I'll probably just speak really briefly and then hope we can have a bunch of questions from you. But so Tom is right. I'm a city councilor in Portsmouth, and I did run specifically on the issue of workforce and affordable housing, and it's an issue that I've been involved in for about a decade now, and so this was sort of a natural progression for me in terms of a position where you could really influence the issue. in law school, did my master's thesis on deregulating zoning ordinances to promote workforce housing. And I worked a lot with Ben Frost at New Hampshire Housing during that time. I was on the State Workforce Housing Advisory Council, and I helped them shape guidance for cities and towns on this issue. And from there, you know, I was away, but I kind of stayed involved. And when I came back, I was on the Workforce Housing Coalition of the Greater Seacoast Board, and then I was on the Portsmouth Housing Authority Board. And this opportunity seems like a chance to kind of really get to the heart of the issue, which is your zoning ordinance and you know, the way that it shapes how we all interact and live in the physical space that is Portsmouth. And so when I got on the council, I asked the mayor, I said, housing is having a moment. Can we do something about it? And he said, sure, and gave me a committee, and I worked very closely with Nancy on that committee. We had three city councilors, chair of the planning board, chair of the zoning board, a commissioner from the Portsmouth Housing Authority to be representational, and then we had three staff. We had Nancy, we had Rick Tanner, director of planning, and Jessa. And so we as housing committee viewed our role very much as, you know, sort of a follow-on to the master plan process and kind of the first step in implementing Portsmouth's brand new master plan. Our housing goals, which were reached through lots and lots and lots of input in the city, you know, all spoke about the value of housing to creating diversity in your community. And, you know, from my perspective, I think our diversity, which includes attracting and retaining young professionals in this city, not just the area, but actually living here in Portsmouth, is absolutely critical to our future as a city. I think from a civic perspective, they need to feel a part of this community and be able to kind of age as part of our community, be in a position to take over on boards and commissions and councils. You know, I think they need to be involved in our schools. I think, you know, if they work in this town, they probably want to be a part of our lives and not have to drive back to Dover or Barrington or Northwood or Stratham or wherever. And I hear that day in and day out. And so I think that's a critical part of our city continuing to thrive and experience the success that it has. And so, you know, we took public input. We took input from developers because they're a critical part of the team of building more housing and shaping our community. And so we ended up with two recommendations. One was that the city council adopt a housing policy, which essentially sits at the city council level. It's in place now, and it kind of speaks about this principles, and it enables the staff to, you know, look for opportunities to incorporate these principles into their decision making and their planning. And then we recommended three zoning ordinance changes, and those are to modify our gateway district to allow residential. And there's a little more nuance to that, which I'm happy to talk about. Exit 7, kind of incorporating residential into the bridge between Atlantic Heights and the new, and, you know, sort of downtown, and allowing that new Market Street improvement to kind of tie those areas together. And then over by Marana Road, you know, opportunity for kind of a more residential to kind of fill in there. And the idea there is just because, you know, there seems to be sensitivity to adding more housing in a lot of our residential areas. And so we really wanted as a committee to impact the issue, make as big of an impact on the issue as we could with as few priority actions as possible so that we could just get the ball rolling. And one of the places where there was real consensus amongst almost everyone we talked to is adding residential to our commercial areas. And so that really is kind of the focus of what came out of the housing committee is places like the Kmart Plaza or Southgate Plaza where Shio is, you know, allowing those to kind of experience some height, see some residential floors go in, you know, the plaza where Planet Fitness is, and have those kind of become more like mixed-use centers of activity where people can live, work, shop, you know, be connected to public transport, that kind of thing. So those changes are being drafted. We're waiting for them to come back, and so this year will be a year where the details of those zoning changes, you know, come before the council and the planning board, and there will be more input, and we'll make sure we try and get it as right as we can. But that's kind of how I'm hoping to see change on that issue.
Good. It's interesting. I do come from across the river in Kittery. I live in Kittery now, but the reason why I'm actually even in this neck of the woods, I'm originally from Lawrence, Massachusetts, and I've been working in city management for about 10 years now, but before that I had been working in planning and community development. And so I worked actually as part of a consulting team that did the 2004 Portsmouth Master Plan, and it was during that period of time that just so happens it was time for me to kind of, you know, invest in a house, you know, get that first home that could be affordable. I had been living in Massachusetts, which was incredibly unaffordable. And so through coming up here and working on as part of the Portsmouth Master Plan, I was able to actually find an affordable place to buy in Kittery. So, and it just so happens that I love living up here, and so I'm very glad to, you know, remain here. Part of what the Master Plan puts forth is a lot of statistical data that you may find interesting that served as the basis for the Housing Committee's work. So what we're looking at in terms of Portsmouth, as you may already know intuitively in any event, is that Portsmouth really is the economic center of the whole area, that Portsmouth with the P's business park essentially has 2.1 jobs for every person that lives in Portsmouth. So even though Portsmouth's population is about 21,000 right now, you know, the daytime population grows to double that, basically, much more beyond that. So Portsmouth looks different than all of the other places that surround it. Also looks different insofar as the housing stock that it provides. So for example, for this 21,000 population, Portsmouth has roughly 11,000 housing units, but those housing units are actually only 39% single family homes. And that is very, very different from any place around Portsmouth. So Portsmouth does have a pretty good diverse stock of housing, but what you'll find, as Rebecca had said, as part of the master plan process, you know, one of the things that the community values most is really this feeling of diversity in the population that exists here and the energy that comes from that. And looking at housing prices and the people that live here in housing stock, you'll find that only, I think it's like 50% of the people that own homes here would not be able to afford to buy a home here now, which is a pretty compelling number. So, you know, we have these conversations, and why is the city involved in housing? Why are we talking about housing? I mean, I think that we're talking about housing in relationship to the workforce that comes here every single day, mm-hmm. and you're talking about housing in terms of the people that you enjoy being neighbors with, mm-hmm. And that being potentially under threat due to the lack of affordability. So I think it's a pretty big issue. Portsmouth's not alone in considering this. You know, if we had a magic bullet solution, we'd be very, very traveling around the country. You know, because other market areas certainly, you know, if you're affording a very good quality of life, you become very popular, and then housing becomes more and more of a topic that you need to address. So. But I'm definitely willing to answer questions. One of the questions that Tom had actually that was part of the title to this this morning was, you know, how does the city go about providing housing? And the city actually doesn't provide housing. So the city of Portsmouth does not build housing, doesn't own housing, doesn't manage any housing. The city doesn't do that. But the Portsmouth Housing Authority, you may be familiar with Margeson Apartments, for example, is a good one. The Portsmouth Housing Authority manages probably, I think it's like 1,100 units of housing throughout the city. And they do that they use pretty much federal and state subsidies in order to build housing that is affordable to certain incomes of the population. The city does offer a first-time home buyer program, so people that are really stretching to get their first home here can come into the city, and if you qualify under certain guidelines that the federal government puts forth, you know, we can give you a grant, essentially, in order to build your first home in the form of a loan that gets forgiven over a period of 15 years' time. The city offers a housing rehabilitation program to help keep people in their houses if their houses need you know, critical improvements. The city can offer help in that way, but the city actually isn't a developer of housing. And the follow-up question was, well, why isn't the city a developer of housing? There are some cities that do develop housing. It's typically, I'm not surprised at all that the city doesn't do it. The city of Portsmouth is a small city. Being able to do that well, you need to be very, very expert in the various subsidy programs that the federal government offers. You need to be expert in housing development. We don't necessarily have that in-house, so we would be looking to partner with somebody that does that very well in order to affect the construction of housing. So the city is maybe most able to affect whether or not housing is here and to do something about housing with regard to its zoning ordinance. So the zoning ordinance is the thing that regulates uses throughout the city. And as Rebecca had said, we just made three recommendations to introduce what I call multifamily or multi-residential housing in the commercial corridor areas, which seems like a natural given that you have, you know, built-in commercial and it's along transit corridors where you can take a bus or you can easily access transportation to build housing in these places where housing traditionally hasn't existed. So
that would also cut down on some of the pushback from neighbors, one would think. There's not a lot of neighbors around Kmart. Pursuant to the question in regards to last week with Chris Dwyer, if the city were interested in that sort of thing, would they have to get permission from the state to do it?
You mean if this were the city interested in building housing?
Yeah.
I wouldn't think we would need to get permission. It would really just be a
matter. The city could do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or the
Portsmouth Housing
Authority. Yeah.
They're getting state and federal money.
Mm-hmm.
They could potentially get city money as well to better do the things that they're doing. If we were as a city to make that a priority.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. For example, if we're willing to go there, you know, Eric Spear's recent proposal for housing on Parrot Avenue. So that was an example of, he was suggesting that the city would build that housing. Now, what that really probably means, and, you know, keep me honest, is the city makes a decision that that's what they want to see happen there, and then they basically issue an RFP that says, somebody come build us this housing, you know, and tell us how the economics would work and what the rent should be and all that kind of stuff. And so some people see the housing authority, if the city were to pursue that strategy like that, some people see the housing authority as a natural partner in that way because they are kind of a quasi-public.
And would the city have authority to say, to put resale restrictions on such a property?
Yep, so.
Like it can only be sold for 10% what you bought it for, that sort of thing.
Yeah,
yes.
You could.
You could.
So most federal programs would come with some type of resale restriction, which are mostly successful, sometimes unsuccessful. So I've been involved in properties that have resale restrictions on them, but if they go to bankruptcy court, which is maybe overcomplicating something, then you need to know what position you're in, and that you could lose affordability in that way. But most of the time, you would record a deed restriction that would say, you know, upon transfer of the property, the new person to come into the property has to income qualify as well.
And you most often see that with rentals, as far as I know.
Yeah, yeah.
There are not actually in place anywhere, I think, in the state restrictions on resale.
Yeah.
That is more
complicated. That was just way back when we were trying to figure out how to allow artists to own and not just rent. That was one of the things that was.
But those are, I mean, I think, aren't in the new West End zoning, aren't there workforce
you
housing
take, yep.
covenants?
Yep. Yep.
So I don't know if maybe we want to talk about that a little bit.
Yep. So part of the new zoning, the state of New Hampshire doesn't allow you to say to a developer you must include some component of affordability in your development. So that is called inclusionary zoning. It probably is called different things in different places, but the state of Massachusetts, for example, allows that. So if you're building a development of a certain number of units, you can say, well, 10% of those units need to be set aside for some type of affordability structure. New Hampshire doesn't allow that. So the thing that we can do in the state of New Hampshire is offer an incentive. for developers of housing to provide that, and that is true of the West End zoning. So you have sort of your base density that you can build to, so you take your lot area and sort of figure out how many units are able to be built on that lot, and you can go, I think it's one floor higher, if you offer affordability as part of your development. This in fact is happening right now as part of the development that's going on
at Deer Street.
Yeah. So the corner of Maplewood and Deer is now programmed to have some type of workforce housing associated with it.
Nancy,
you have an update. So.
We're talking apartments probably.
Yes. Yeah.
Is that where Wells Fargo is? Is that where you mean? Or?
It's.
Well, no, we're up on Maplewood.
So that whole
the corner.
Yeah.
For those who don't know, basically, you know, there's a proposal for essentially that whole area, and that's it was in front of the planning board, and now it's been passed on to HDC. At least the two buildings that are in the HDC, right?
But that's why I'm here, actually.
Yep.
Because the HDC has an issue with the height and the scale.
Yep.
And the developers try to explain that they need that in order to make the economics work to offer, I think it's even more than 10%.
I think it is,
of, workforce housing.
I think it might be 10%.
And so that's why I'm just not sure all of our boards and commissions understand or are on the same page or, so I don't know what the right answer to that is, but I'm seeing pushback and
So, I mean, I think that question goes to the economics of all of this, right? I mean, you know, there's sort of the regulatory side, but that the regulatory side is really just there. Regulations tell you what you can't do, you know, and we've been talking about this a lot lately because it would be really nice if we could just write zoning that says, we'd like you to do this, you know? But unfortunately, that's not really the situation we're presented with. And so, what we have to do is work collaboratively, listening to the residents on this end and the developers over here and kind of best practices across the country over here and figure out, you know, how can we see a vision and then zone it so that the economics can make that a reality, you know, and I think this is a good example. It's a lot of times in order to include these workforce housing units, obviously the developer's not getting the same rent they could in a market rate apartment. So they're leaving some money on the table. In order to kind of recoup that money and make the project work, they need to be able to include, you know, a certain number of other units at a certain price to kind of make the profit margin kind of even out over all the units. Now, something I hear a lot of is, well, the developers just want to make a lot of money, and why do they get to make so much money? And I get that. You know, I think everybody's totally entitled to feel that way about any business they want to, but in my opinion, you know, they're just like any other business as well. They are, in a lot of cases, they're local developers, and I, in every case, would much rather have a local developer sitting at the table with us than someone from somewhere else, you know, another country or another place. And and keeping those local guys who know our city and know our environment, you know, at the table and in business, I think is critical because they really are part of the community. They're civic, you know, they give to other causes. So I think, you know, we do have to realize that without them and without their ability to make any profit and without their co-investors, you know, we're not going to have any housing, new housing, you know, and so I see them as a critical part of the team. And so I think we have to think about the economics when we're trying to tackle this problem. We can't just say, this is what we want, and kind of ignore the rest of the pieces, you know. There's a question. I don't know if you wanted to say anything else.
As far as Portsmouth's master plan, and you're talking about economics and the demographic changes that are going to be coming as we have an aging population, and they're going to be doing, you know, what they need to do for themselves. They may not want to live in their houses anymore.
Yeah.
If you're thinking about economics, what does it look like 10 years out, 20 years out, if we don't have you know, housing for younger people who are going to be earning wages for the next 20, 30 years.
Yeah.
So how does that get included for the city's master plan? How does housing come into that in terms of economic planning?
It's a goal.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a very good comment. I mean, the city's population overall hasn't really changed a whole lot as far as we can tell with regard to census to census, you know, increases. It's pretty stable for the most part. And the projections aren't that the city is going to explode in population into the future either. One of the things that the census does tell us is that in the last 10 years, the population of 35 to 44 year olds are moving out and the population is aging. So I think that part of the discussion that we've had at the housing committee is how can you, and we've heard from people coming to the meetings as well, saying, you know, I want to move out of my big house, you know, but there's nothing for me to move into. So part of the thinking is trying to provide smaller units that would be attractive to people who are no longer interested in living in their single family homes. As I said, Portsmouth actually, I forget the statistic, but has a larger number of people living alone than anywhere surrounding as well, actually. Yeah, so it's kind of surprising to me. So, so the census measures who lives in what households and how do they live, who are they living with, essentially. And it breaks down between family households and non-family households. And non-family households can involve people who are unrelated, but they can also have single people in there. 46%, which is the lowest in the region of places that we look to compare ourselves to, 46% live in family households. So over half live in non-family households in Portsmouth. So we have to think about what types of housing, you know, we're seeking to locate here to accommodate this population.
Is that part of the master plan for Portsmouth from
is.
City Council? I mean, I'm trying to figure out, is it a matter of will? Is it a matter of, come ask about the state legislature and whether the city has permission to do this. And you said they did, the city does. So I'm asking, is it a matter of just shifting, a paradigm shift in terms of changing, the world is changing. So
mm-hmm.
I'm just trying to find out, you
mm-hmm.
said something about policy, so where is this happening? I can kind of hear on your commissions, which are very focused, but there's also an overview that's coming from somewhere where policy does or doesn't get established. So I'm just trying to hear from you where that's going on, where change might occur outside of the commissions that are focused.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. I'll take a shot at it.
Okay.
Maybe you can help.
Okay.
I think that the council having adopted a housing policy is actually a very strong statement to the future as to how Portsmouth is considering housing as part of the things that it does or does not do. So until the work of the housing committee, there wasn't such a policy in place, although the master plan does make policy statements. The master plan regulates land use for the most part. And until now, well, our zoning right now does not allow, as an allowed use, a building of over 8 units. So if you want to build anything that's above 8 units anywhere in the city, you have to go to the zoning board for relief. So the zoning right now is not really terribly conducive to developing any units of any density. This is except for the downtown core. Except for the downtown core in the West End. The zoning doesn't really, it's kind of a barrier more than it is a help
mm-hmm.
in allowing housing to happen. So we're fixing that. However, I will say that, the rubber tends to meet the road in committees, in the land use approvals that need to be acquired before a project can move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that by the council coming out with a statement, the council is the policy-making body.
Mm-hmm.
And so the council is telling the people that work as part of the city, you employees should think about welcoming these proposals in, but you as board members should also keep in mind that it's the
mm-hmm.
policy of the city to be looking for opportunities to build housing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that that's kind of, that'll work in conjunction with, getting the zoning correct. It'll help the board see these proposals in maybe a little bit of a different light than, you know, they have in the past.
Yeah, and I mean, I think, you know, your question kind of goes to, like, how do we get this ball moving? You know, I mean, we're talking and talking and talking, and I think Nancy's right on here, but it's also like anything, you know, it's a matter of making it important enough to people that something happens, you know, and I think being able to say, okay, you know, the master plan was formed through lots of dialogue. Master plan says diversity. We're taking the master plan to the housing committee. Housing committee says allow more housing. It'll promote diversity. You know, housing committee says zoning changes. The zoning changes say this. Blah, blah. And, you know, you kind of have to, like, get all these different things done to just create a little change, you know? And so it requires not just, like, an understanding of all that stuff and all those layers, but you know, will, like you said. And I think, you know, kind of will from the residents and will to show up at the planning board and not just say, I hate this project, but rather once in a while, this would be great, you know? And that would be really nice for us in the city to kind of, because we hear this stuff, you know, we hear online or we get an email and it says, like, this sounds really good or we really like that. And then, you know, the planning board, unfortunately, like, people are really motivated when they don't like something and they're just not as motivated when they like something, you know? And that's kind of a reality of our system. And so Nancy and I talk sometimes about government and how local government works and, you know, and I think part of it is trying to also listen to that feedback and figure out, is there a way we can incorporate other kinds of feedback into these hearings? Is there a way we could capture some of that positive feedback, you know, so that the decisions of our boards and commissions are truly reflective of the citizenry? But, you know, for now, I think the best thing we can absolutely do is create consensus at the zoning level. You know, if we can enact an ordinance that reflects what we all think, that's the best and most efficient way to allow the boards and commissions to just enact that, you know, and not really, like, take all those discussion points off the table, make it clear in the law, and then just let it execute. And that's hard. You know, that's not easy, but I think it's worth doing. And so that's what we're trying to do. Two questions that...
This guy's just had his
head. Okay.
Can you elaborate on to what extent zoning is preventing new housing from being built?
I could go on for a really long time about that, but, you know, it's everything. So it controls all of our land in the city and how we can do anything. And from my perspective, when I hear, you know, when I talk to developers or even residents that want to see more housing here, it really is. It's all about the zoning. And you know, our planning board and our HDC and, you know, our ZBA are all creatures of state statute. So we have little influence over how they function, but we do have influence over the ordinance that they function under. So I would love to speak more specifically within that to your question, but I mean, it's critical. It is literally the underpinning of how we do everything.
And
so,
and to clarify,
yeah,
there's plenty of housing being built in Portsmouth.
Okay, yes. There are new residential units being built downtown in Portsmouth, yes. So
they're not affordable.
They're not affordable.
They're not affordable. So I just, it
there's
was your question
there.
Specifically affordable, I mean.
Yeah, it was like
specifically like,
yeah, a lot of people are here today because
yeah,
they think that
yeah,
what they'd like to see built is not
yeah,
being built, and
yeah,
so I'm wondering to what extent is zoning preventing that?
Yeah. Well, I think it's zoning in part, and not in small part, but affordability is linked to the overall market and how land prices, what
yep,
their costs are.
I've
so, for
that,
example, even down at Southgate, the project that's going up behind Shio and the Cinemagic basically is adding something like 98 units. And those rents are already established at like $2,000 a month. Right? So that's a project that was allowed. It was allowed through the gateway zoning. Basically, the gateway zoning sought to introduce residential into commercial centers. This developer came in and said, you know what, we'd love to do it right there. I mean, in a way, you can see how that's all going to be a nice little walkable place. But it doesn't mean that, you know, they're building affordably because their costs are high, they want to make money, you know, all of those things.
Yeah, so let's,
so,
I mean, but let's dig into that for
yeah,
a minute just so that we're making sure we get it. So zoning kind of interacts with the land underneath it, right? And as Nancy said, you know, when you have a place like Portsmouth, everybody wants to be here.
land costs just keep going up. So there's also the cost of what exists there. You know, for example, I always use this Kmart Plaza just because I feel like it's an easy example to point to. It's sitting there vacant, right? So in theory, we should be able to get something built there. Well, first of all, the zoning didn't allow it at all. So now we've gone through housing committee. Yep. This is a zoning change. Now we want to allow residential there. So now the developers have to know residential is allowed there. Okay, now they know that. Now they have to come see, all right, the building exists there. Would I leave it there? Would I demolish it? How many units can I build? What density did you establish in your zoning ordinance? Did you establish 2,500 square feet per dwelling unit? Did you establish 15,000 square feet per dwelling unit? So how, you know, what size unit do I think the market wants? And so they kind of do all this calculating, right? And what I've heard, for example, there is like, they would probably leave the Kmart building there because it's really expensive to demolish something like that. So the residential would kind of come above that and the floors above that. Mm. But that is sounds like it might be an economic proposition. So you have to kind of think about their costs coming into that. And then one of the big costs is the unpredictability of going through the boards. And so again, it comes back to your zoning ordinance. If you say clearly in your zoning ordinance, if you build this, it is allowed, the developer can look at that and go, okay, I know what I'm allowed to do. I can predict this much for legal costs. I can predict this much for engineering. I can predict this much for architect. If you say something like, well, you can do this under these certain circumstances, if the board approves it, under conditional use permit, you know, if you get a variance for height and maybe you build some civic space, okay, like, I'm glad it's allowed, but at the same time, they kind of have to anticipate, I'm going to have to get a conditional use permit before the planning board. When I go to the planning board, are they going to tell me, no, go back, we don't like this, redraw this part, why are you doing the parking spaces here, why is it this many units, I don't like the mass, you know, and then they have to go back to the architect, get a new drawing, bring that back. And that's the right of the planning board, but again, I think it's much easier if you just make those decisions as a community in your zoning ordinance so that a developer can see clearly what we've decided is okay with us, you know, and not necessarily leave that up to the planning board. Is that helping? Answer?
Yeah, that
okay.
gives me a lot more information to work with. Thank you.
Okay. Yep.
I was just curious, to bump it up to the state level.
Yeah.
Is there any state level housing advocacy group that's pushing to allow communities and municipalities to create that 10% workforce housing in any given project to enable that to be possible? Because the state. And this is also, I also live in Kittery,
yeah.
And this is also an issue along the seacoast in York County, and kind of, you know.
Yeah.
Because this lack of housing is driving homelessness,
yeah.
It's driving massive out-migration
yeah.
of people who are graduating from college. I mean, they're all leaving, or they're moving, I mean, I volunteer at a community health center in town, and we're even seeing our homeless population, which is 25% of our 5,300 active patients. They're even getting, I shouldn't say they're even, but our homeless populations are migrating out. Our young people are migrating out of the region, or they're going out of state.
Yeah.
You know, so I think at a state level, wouldn't it behoove the state and its future economic and diversity and et cetera, to enable this, but deaf ears, I guess.
I wouldn't say deaf ears. It's, you know, the ability to start conversations that limit municipal power
that's
in
right.
Concord are,
right.
you know, it's very limited. So,
your way.
Yeah, you know, we have 234 political jurisdictions in New Hampshire, and they all want to run their own school district. You know, they want to run their own zoning, they want to, you know, despite whatever evidence we could probably produce from other places in the country that, you know, coordinated transportation networks and coordinated housing plans and coordinated, I mean, there is regional zoning in some places out west. So, you know, this year what's happening at the state level is an ask to put money from the state's capital improvement budget into the Workforce Housing Trust Fund, which essentially would allow money to kind of filter through competitive processes to add into that developer balance sheet, you know, kind of give money into a developer project so that they can kind of make the economics work where the zoning doesn't. But that's, even that, you know, it seems like a big ask, even though.
Yeah, it's too bad. I mean, because you talk to people like Steve Norton at the New Hampshire Center for Public Policy, and the data is just overwhelming. The state's got some serious problems, and they were right at the doorstep. A lot of it is related to housing, other things as well.
Sure. And it's also related to the structure of our legislature, but a big question. Yeah.
Well, I think the big question comes is, what do you want for affordable housing? You
mm-hmm.
mean, I mean, I look at affordable housing as apartments for young people working away, and not where they're going to retire. Because if you get to building single family homes, then okay, Newcastle has an affordable housing thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's by the economics and the dynamics of property.
Mm-hmm.
And if you live in a neighborhood where your house is worth $500,000, you do not want someone to build a house that's worth $250,000. That changes your market value overnight. So it's never going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And then if our retirees, you know, are not going to be able to move to downtown, there's only that one yellow building that has an apartment, and you can't walk, you can't even take a bus to get to a drugstore or to a supermarket. So this is not going to be a mega city. And, you know, you mentioned 1,100 units, the housing partnership. Well, what's the average population there? Two people? So that 10% of our population is managed by a housing partnership.
Mm-hmm.
That is affordable housing. It's a lot different than creating this la-la land of having a second tier of houses with a fence around it and where your kids can walk to Little Harbor School. You know, that stock is taken.
Yeah.
And the value of that's never going to go down.
Yeah, I agree with you totally. You don't have to start on
that. can you give a quick update on the accessory dwelling unit?
Yeah, can we tackle that one a tiny bit?
Yeah, I just feel like
maybe
it's a little
related.
Connection there.
Yeah, I was going to talk about good demand.
Yeah.
For small units. Okay. You guys have us in our core subject here. But so basically, I mean, you're right on. And one thing we didn't get to touch on at all yet, which is too bad because it's really at the heart of the issue, is that young professionals and, you know, baby boomers / coming retirees all want the same thing. There's this huge shift in the market in terms of demand for units. They all want these smaller units, like condoized smaller units where a young person can come home to sleep and then get up, commute to their job, go meet their friends after work, you know, get a beer, come home at 10 p.m., sleep, get up, you know, like they don't have to spend a lot of time taking care of a yard, and it's a smaller unit. Retirees want the same thing. They want to be somewhere they can, you know, not spend a lot of time mowing the lawn and doing all that stuff, but they can walk down to the bookstore and get a coffee on Sunday morning, and they can maintain mobility, and they can stay in their community. And so we're in a lucky position because, you know, the market wants smaller units, and that's what's not being built, and that's why prices are going up on those smaller units. But
yeah, it's well stated. I mean, part of what the master plan does do is kind of match population with the types of units that are offered, and that is the mismatch that's been identified. Is this, you know, we don't have enough smaller units for people that want to live in smaller units.
What is the best way to try and stay on top of what's going on? Because I usually don't know what's going on unless there's a huge controversy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Pick a day.
I'm one of those people in the group of like the 35
yes.
to, you know, that are maybe,
yeah.
you know, I've lived here for
yep.
12 years and it's
yeah.
been a struggle
yeah.
to stay
yeah.
in Portsmouth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I love it and I care about it,
yeah.
but I don't really know the best way to stay on top of it and involve myself.
Okay.
So.
It's hard, and I totally get it, and, you know, I think all of us think, oh, well, if I was just in government, I would communicate all this stuff more, and then you get in government, and you're like, I'm buried in reading, and we try, I think, to let people know what we're up to. One way, if you're super interested, is to join the Housing Huddle, which meets the fourth Tuesday of every month at 8 a.m. at the Chamber, and that's just a group of organizations that's interested in housing and is coordinating amongst themselves.
Is it fourth Tuesday of every month?
Fourth Tuesday of every month, yeah.
There's the newsletter. So you can sign up on the city's website to receive a newsletter that pretty much tells you all of the things that are going on in the city.
That's the Portsmouth, like the general Portsmouth newsletter.
Yeah.
I'm already on that.
We're trying to improve that. That's coming.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how the council should feel. I feel as though, you know,
it's hard.
People that come to council meetings and speak at public session, if you were coming and just saying, you know, I'm really interested in housing, you know, is there anything that the city can do about housing? And if that was like a consistent message, you know, even absent a project, you know, because I think it's kind of hard sometimes to get out of your house and go support a housing project somewhere that's not in your neighborhood and seems kind of tangential to your life sometimes. I mean, the people that come to the board meetings are the people that are really interested because it's there, it's near them, it's, you know, they're impacted by it. We talk a lot about impacts, so, you know, those are the people that are most vocal during those meetings. But I think, again, you know, it's the council that makes decisions with regard to zoning changes and allowing things to happen and not allowing things. And I feel like, you know, just speaking at a council meeting or even writing a letter, you know, you don't have to come out all the time. You can just say, look, I'm interested in housing. You know, I want the council, I applaud the council's action on the housing policy now that you know about it. and keep it up kind of thing. You know, keep up the good work.
And I don't know what the answer to this is, but as someone who talks to townspeople a lot.
Yeah.
I will tell you that people still don't know, despite the Herald and many articles, people are still very vague on what's happening at Harper Court. It has something to do with the Whole Foods. They have no idea that everything around it is already permitted.
Also, yeah.
Like, no idea at all.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, did who in here knew that where the VFW is already permitted?
Right.
Yeah.
Inside information.
It's not fair to developers to have them get halfway down the road and then everyone be like, hey, wait a minute. And then my question somewhat related to that is there seems a disconnect between commercial permitting or zoning and residential zoning. So why do we allow a hotel to be built that's going to be staffed by people who cannot live here, which is going to add to the traffic problems, to all sorts of things? Is there any connection in that thought process?
Good question. Okay. Because this is pretty frequently a misunderstanding that, you know, another hotel, why does the city want another hotel to come in, you know? Zoning, when you write it, has to be fair and equitable to every owner that is within the zone, so to speak. So you cannot, except in certain instances in the state of Maine, for example, you cannot take a parcel and zone it substantially differently than the things that are around it. So the zones in the city work together as a group. We draw a line around an area and say, in this area, these are the uses that are allowed, and you have to treat everybody equally in that vein. So the downtown is a place where hotels are allowed. And it is the market that determines whether or not another hotel, you know, can come here. And it's phenomenal to me that so many hotels can be profitable in this tiny place. But we do have three that are coming? Another three that are being permitted or already permitted. And in speaking with people, not being familiar with the room market, you know, I've talked to fellow staff members who had a death in the family and is looking for a room, you know, for their family to come for the funeral and can't find one. The rooms are actually booked.
Yeah.
So,
like in February, yeah.
Yeah, it's a businessman. I mean, I see it. I go Wednesday night trivia at British Beer Company, and they come in. They're going to that day at Pease's, but they want to stay in Portsmouth because it's a great place to have dinner or have a 9 o'clock, you know, cocktail.
Yeah.
I just wrote an article for a Business New Hampshire magazine on hotels in this state.
Okay.
They said Earl Wasson, who was here in town, real estate guy for over 30 years, interviewed a lot of people. He said that Portsmouth is an enigma, very different from anywhere else in the state, and that there are 19 hotels, and that the occupancy is between 90% and 95% here, whereas the state average is 61%. But he also said in some of the research I did that the rates are about 5% higher than the United States average. So,
yeah,
you know,
and
there, and I talked to Nancy Carmer, and she just said because of the way that this place is, the people love, it's walkable, there are, you know, other forces coming into the city that don't necessarily live here, but come in, bring energy and ideas.
And for those of you who weren't here last week, Chris Dwyer told us that Rockingham County generates, I think she said, 70% of the rooms and meals tax for the state, and we get 9% back. So, and there was part of the discussion last week was about a specific hotel tax, city tax, and that you need state legislation to do it, and that sort of back and forth. I don't want to go back there, but yes, that, and I remember distinctly about 10 years ago asking the banker why there were so many goddamn banks, and she's like, because there's so much money. Like, she's like, we're not even fighting against each other. There's just so much investment.
Oh, it's that likability issue. Everybody wants to have lunch in Portsmouth, you know, so the, you know, it's just, and that takes up parking, and that takes up, you know, and having stores that would be attractive to residents and tourists here. A bank does no good for it. I'm a banker, and I don't, and that adds no value to your community.
But really here's the thing. I know Nancy's working on this sort of thing. It's like, yes, the ocean's part of that, the environment's part of that, but a huge part of that is the restaurants, the shops, and the arts and culture.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the people who are employing the people who can't live here.
Yeah.
And so if we want to maintain, if we think that's just gonna merrily roll along forever without unintended consequences, it's probably not. I keep jumping.
But it's a good problem. Everybody wants to live here and visit here.
It's a wonderful
problem to have.
You
mean, the hotels could do it. They would, if they got 95% occupancy, as a banker, say, okay, then raise the rates $10 or no.
No, you would, right?
Yeah.
And I mean, that's the thing is you have to, I know that sometimes we're sort of victims of our own success in our mind, you know, and there's all this, I know you do this too. I like to kind of like listen via Facebook to, you know, Seacoast Online articles will get posted. And you know, I don't get to do it often, but sometimes there's 200 comments on an article and I'm like, well, this is a whole conversation that happened, you know, and they're not, there are definitely ones where everybody's just yelling at each other. But so much of the time I'm super impressed. Like they are incredibly thoughtful conversations. People are pulling in articles and Wikipedia and like all this stuff and so, you know, I like to listen to it, but it's, we have a feeling like there's all these other people coming here using our city, you know, and I just, you go to other parts of the state and they just don't have that problem and they wish they did, you know, and I understand it can be overwhelming. We feel it too, you know, there are days you don't try to come downtown, but you know, I mean, the rest of the time we still get to live here, you know, and it's this wonderful little place and we've got this magic formula going. And I just, for my part, I just feel like the message is to keep this little balance we've got, you know, we do have to keep growing. That is how we maintain status quo, is having a few more people every year. And I think someone said at some point, if we had a 1% growth in housing stock every year, we could keep pace with stuff much better. We don't even have that 1%. And so, I just, you know, I think there's stuff we can do, but it just requires this kind of constant, government requires you to keep moving it forward, you know? And so you try to keep at it, I guess.
He had earlier asked about the accessory dwelling.
So Portsmouth, so the state last year passed legislation that essentially mandated that communities adopt zoning that would allow for accessory dwelling units, which would, let's see how to describe them. So if you have a single family home, you are now able to add an addition or a separate outbuilding on your lot, subject to setback requirements, but not lot area requirements, that would essentially, you know, promote more affordability, I think, by increasing housing stock. So there was recently a seminar given at the Levinson Room in the library with
mm-hmm.
regard to all of the details, which is probably available online somewhere.
It was a PS21
if you're, very interested. But the day after that seminar was given, we had a line out the door at the planning office for people
really?
That are interested. Yeah, actually, we did.
Fascinating.
Yeah. For people that are interested in doing that. So. That has definitely opened the door to a different type of housing that will be allowed here. And for any of the details, you should really call the planning office to find out if you're interested in doing that. But essentially, it allows two-family use throughout the city.
And so, and just to be clear, the state law mandated that Portsmouth allow it anywhere that single-family homes are currently allowed. And so we were allowed to put some restrictions around that, But I mean, for example, at Housing Committee, you know, we were trying to make changes that would allow for a whole bunch of units to go into a place people are okay with. This is the total opposite. It's like one unit here, one unit there, and in theory, they're almost invisible. You know, the way that they're restricted, you likely would not even know they were there. And Portsmouth has all these cool, like carriage houses and kind of historic buildings on people's property. And so you can also, put ADUs in those as long as you don't change them, you know, because the idea is that they already kind of reflect the nature of that neighborhood, and so if you just leave them there and kind of convert the inside, you can put ADUs in there too.
We're getting close to 10. I want to ask you each a question. Hopefully you'll stick around a little bit longer and answer if anyone's got more questions. But for you, I didn't realize you were part of the 2004 master plan. I was part of that. I was on the West End zoning and all those sort of things. My question for you, and you can probably guess my answer, is as we move to a new master plan, was that 2004 master plan effective? Did we as a town do the things in it that we wanted to do?
I think so, in large part. So people tend to not remember what zoning was like prior to the 2004 master plan. So that master plan was followed up with a comprehensive revision of zoning. So the zoning ordinance almost was like thrown out and completely rewritten as a result of that master plan. So I do think that a lot of the items, and we have a list, you know, ongoing in the planning department of what that plan set forth, were accomplished. Some of them are retained in this master plan and just keep going, and housing continues to be one of those issues. And as part of the last master plan, one of the questions was, how do we make the rest of Portsmouth as special as the downtown?
Mm.
And out of that plan, the gateway zoning was adopted, and now this plan pushes that even forward. And so this plan was still becoming finalized when the Housing Committee kind of took up its work and is following through already on this version of the master plan. So,
and my question for you is, one of the things that I've heard come up in this conversation over and over is saying we want diversity of citizenry, and that's important to us, and housing is a good way to affect that. And then also saying, oh, but there's market forces.
Mm-hmm.
You are only going to get that first thing by defeating the second.
Yeah. Well, not defeating.
Yes, defeating. I mean,
perhaps working
okay.
with.
Right.
Okay.
Working with, whatever. But
okay.
But as has been pointed out, Portsmouth is a very special place in New Hampshire where the
yes.
market forces are completely different.
Yeah.
And yet they're not different than places like Soho, New York, or
right.
or Portland.
Yeah.
And, you know, we don't fix this problem without breaking the mold. I don't see how we fix this problem by
doing the same old
yeah.
thing. No, I completely agree with you. So I don't, well, I'll say one thing. I don't know if we need to defeat market forces, but you know, I agree completely with what you're saying. I mean, this is why I ran for office and why I spend these countless hours talking about housing and reading about zoning and bothering Nancy on her voicemail. And, you know, I feel really passionately about this. We need to do something. You know, there needs to be action around this issue and instead of endless talk. And so, you know, I know it maybe sounds like a flimsy little policy and some zoning changes, but, you know, it's more than we've done in, other than this rewriting the zoning ordinance in a long time. And it's not just the zoning ordinance, and I don't mean to focus on that totally. That is a huge part of it. But it's also this conversation, you know, it's you guys asking these questions and understanding it. It's like, I can't, it's this interesting experience for me because I can't tell you how many times I feel like I'm kind of trying to bring everybody into the conversation and I'm like, isn't everybody bored of hearing me say the same thing, you know? But I'm always kind of finding that there's new people to talk to. And I think, you know, this whole community needs to like buy in and understand this issue and really kind of like get into it. And that is a massive undertaking. You know, I don't think I or Nancy or Nancy or anybody can like individually make this happen, but I do think we can as a city. And I think it's just a matter of like being bold and getting out there. Like, I want to see these zoning changes enacted. I hope you'll all come out to the planning board, but I'm already thinking about what's next too. You know, I mean, I think we just have to keep going. One of the visions that's in the master plan is these kind of interconnected centers of activity in Portsmouth. And so allowing residential to fill into our commercial zones, that creates a center. It creates a center of activity. It allows us to kind of identify a place that will be a draw, you know, like Shio and McKinnon's and that kind of mixed-use center that's emerging there. Then we can plan transportation around that. You know, we can kind of do all these things. There's all these layers that can keep our city transforming into this vision, but again, you know, we need people to participate in that process, and if you have ideas how we can get the word out better, please tell me. I'm open to doing anything.
I think you're very, very eloquent, spot on at the beginning of saying there's a big difference between somebody who lives in Lowell and drives in to work,
mm-hmm.
and somebody who lives here and works here in terms of civic engagement and that.
Absolutely.
And this Nancy over here, who's also a city, if you don't know, you were pushing back about defeating market forces, but one of the things that Nancy has been working on is a sort of public recognition of what some of the economic drivers are,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
I think we have a long way to go in that, in terms of making regular citizens realize why it's important to have
arts and culture. No,
pushing the arts and culture.
Yeah, absolutely.
Can I speak to that?
Yeah.
So one thing that I don't think people make the connection with when they're lamenting about the hotels and the development and things that are happening in the downtown, that's actually good for the arts and culture scene that's bringing people here and that gives Portsmouth its vitality. The Portwalk, the residents at Portwalk, they all get a membership to 3S Art Space and the Music Hall. The new proposed boutique hotel that's going in down at the Vaughan Street parking, they're gonna put in a whole river walk with a sculpture garden that 3S can curate. I mean, there's all these connections being made that are good for arts and culture. The missing piece is the housing,
mm-hmm.
though. That's
mm-hmm.
the missing piece.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like they're doing a lot for their community because they are local, most of them are locally based, and the cultural institutions are benefiting. Who's falling off the radar are the actual creators and the workers.
Yeah.
And that's what Rebecca's work is so important. It all has to work together to work with the market forces and not fight them.
I lived in Austin, Texas, and I was on the zoning the zoning committee of Austin Tomorrow. And I was very active with the League of Women Voters. And so what I'm saying here is I go back to Austin every once in a while, and I get so excited about all the things that happened because of that planning 30 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
40 years ago. It was a long time. Okay, it was in the 70s. Okay, so Austin Tomorrow had community people coming. You might want to think about this. Community people coming together, being on all these committees about housing, zoning, schools, and came up with a lot of information for the master plan. And going back there, 40 years later, I see all these things that would not have happened if we didn't have Austin Tomorrow. And it was preservation of neighborhoods,
mm-hmm.
because they were
mm-hmm.
being wrecked by
yeah.
developers.
Yeah.
All these flim-flammy buildings going up, destroying
yeah.
beautiful historical properties,
right.
just a whole lot of things. I know you may hear me talking, you think, oh, that's just But anyway, it preserved a lot of what Austin, and yeah, there was license plates later on when the city was growing too fast, keep Austin weird.
Yeah.
And so we were part of that.
Yeah.
And there was a very strong neighborhood council, which I was very active in. So I was coming at it from a whole bunch of different things, and I can see the difference that that made.
Yeah.
And so it is, you have to get people involved. And the process of bringing people together made them more aware of, oh, so how are these other forces working?
Mm-hmm.
And I think softened the way people reacted to developers. Because they were our enemies. They were destroying our neighborhoods, right? At the beginning. And by the end of it, there was a very different feeling about the interaction that you need. And who was then elected to city council and all that sort of thing, too. I don't think that's a problem here. But in Austin, there were too many developers that were on city council, and the people's voice was not being heard.
Interesting.
I think I just want to make one other point clear in terms of what the city does to affect housing and where it is that the city has now long recognized that you can't plunk housing down without also addressing the amenities that go along with housing, such as transportation, for example. So the council also has passed a complete streets policy, and we work very hard to transform otherwise unfriendly pedestrian and bicycle environments into more friendly environments. So that is definitely part of the thinking when we're thinking about, you know, where housing can be located along these commercial corridors. It can take a long time, but there is a plan for Route 1 going down to the Rye Line to become pedestrian and bicycle friendly. And we are working with the state on that. So I think that, you know, that is one of the affirmative things in a little bit of a breaking in the mold kind of way that the city is thinking about, because historically, you know, cities grew from the core outwards, and the core would provide you with all the sidewalks, you know, et cetera, because there's a density of population here that makes sidewalks logical and affordable. But now, but didn't used to, as cities evolved, you know, build sidewalks out in rural areas where, you know, people essentially can't walk to any services, can't really ride their bike. But this city and this council has figured out that in order for housing to be successful outside of the core, we have to think about all those other little things, you know, recreation areas, sidewalk areas, bicycle areas, all that stuff, and commercial going alongside housing.
And I think you're right on, you know, and it's, you, everything you just said is stuff that I think we're thinking about in Portsmouth, you know, and above all, that concept of authenticity that you spoke about, you know, I mean, our neighborhoods are a critical part of the city and super important to keep alive. And I think, you know, part of what's so cool about the city is, like, you can walk down the street and see people you know. And I think that if we ever lost that, that would, we just become anywhere USA, you know? So I think it's definitely balancing all that stuff, and I think we can keep Portsmouth loud and growing and neighborhoods.
Yeah, just, I'm an architect and planner by profession, and I work with the dark arts of development. And there's always kind of misperceptions, and you have to understand that a developer, form follows finance. A developer has financing for his project the same way you have financing for your house. A developer can't go to his bankers and his financiers and say, oh, I'm only going to charge half rent, any more than, you know, I'm only going to charge $1,140, which is including utilities, which is this workforce housing number, in a town where the median rent is $2,700. That won't happen any more than you can go to your mortgagee and say, oh, you know, I'm only going to pay half this month. They're going to kick you out. It just doesn't work. Then the other piece of it, if you've ever filled out a real estate pro forma, the developer's percentage, everyone's, oh, you know, real estate developers, they're all rich and greedy and all that kind of thing. Well, there are no poor real estate developers. If you're a poor real estate developer, you're doing something else. you can't do that anymore. If you're not good at it, you leave the profession and you do something else. So, and the financing gives them incentive to make money in order to protect the, I'm gonna pick on you because you're a banker, protect the bank's position.
Yeah.
They make enough incentive in the process to make it work. So we have to work. Defeating the market is not an option. You may need to find a different part of the market. So when Portsmouth decided we're gonna have form-based codes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bankers who lend money to build hotels know that Portsmouth is a profitable place to do business. The most of the aspects that they need, perhaps absent the regulatory piece, it is in place here. Okay, they can make money. They're looking at this and they say, this is a place where we want to work. Well, the day after Portsmouth adopted form-based codes, I'm on all these different planning websites and planning things. All of a sudden, the next few days, every one of them identified Portsmouth, New Hampshire, which is this wonderful place to live, has now said they're going to allow form-based codes. So all the developers and the people who are interested in developing new urbanism and all this kind of stuff, Portsmouth all of a sudden got on their radar, because now that looks like something we ought to look at. Different bankers, different developers. So we haven't defeated the market. We're going around and pulling a different piece of the market into place. Right, and that's who you want, and just that act, just by, because it gets out there, and you know, there are developers and bankers looking, it's their job, they want to make money, they have to find places where that works. So all of a sudden they look at Portsmouth. So I think the biggest problem is not, it's the cost of land. To buy, let me just give you a quick primer on development economics. You buy a piece of property for $1 million, I can tell you how many units you need to put on that property to make money. It's 25. Because your land acquisition can be no more than 20% of your overall thing, right? So
yeah.
if you buy a piece of property for $1 million, you gotta do a $5 million development. Of that $5 million, 60% is hard cost, you know, rough numbers, 60% is hard cost. This is how much it's gonna cost to build the building. That means you've got $3 million to build a building. It costs about $150 a square foot to build in this community. That leaves you, and apartments, two bedroom apartments, are about 100 square feet, 25 units, that's what you have. Now, in Portsmouth, find a piece of property for only $1 million that at the same time allows you to put 25 units on it, plus the parking associated with it, plus the setbacks. That's a really difficult thing to address. Almost all workforce or affordable housing gets built with various a cocktail of subsidies.
Yeah.
Okay, so when I'm saying, you know, you need 25 units, and I'm talking about market rate. I'm not talking about something that is less than half of the local market.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where all the subsidies and the other pieces come into the equation. So I know people like to find the bad guy, or like to find one single nexus point for where there's a problem, and it's developer greed. Well, if you took all of the developer profit out of a project, and that if the developer made 0 cents on a project, you're never gonna get from 2,700 to 1,100, because the developer's overall piece might be 10% of the whole thing. It just, you could take them out of the equation, and the cost of building and the cost of land simply don't allow housing. So you gotta work on all the margins and pull all the margins in, and everyone has to work together to do that, because
mm-hmm.
there's no silver bullet.
Mm-hmm.
My 2 cents.
Well, that's
or more
depressing.
Than
that. No, that was
no, what it says is now you gotta pull at the zoning piece, and you gotta find different developers, and you gotta pull at the regulatory piece. But you can't just, you're not going to take one shot and solve
right.
the problem.
And when I say we come to these
yeah.
events to find
to
out
learn.
Things we didn't know,
yeah.
this is that's
yeah.
exactly
yeah.
the kind of thing. And
yeah,
of course, in one of the ways around that is for a city to say, or someone to say, here's some land, but we don't really have a lot of city land.
Mm-hmm.
We
no, we
have
don't
almost
have
none.
Right, but that is, I mean, and actually, this is for those following along for a while. Bernie Sanders did a land trust program back in Burlington, like in the 1970s. And, you know, there are programs where cities manage land and trade land and extend land, you know, for like people to build their first home or build a building. So it has happened. Our land is very limited in terms of buildable.
Some of it's landfill, so.
And some of it's wetlands, and some, you know, so it's limited, but it's out there. It's an idea.
Land's two things. Land is the development, and it's parking. Is what happens. Is that, so we're trading off.
Parking.
You know, put 20 units in, you know, on Parrot Street. Now you've taken away the parking, and now you've added, you need more parking for the 20 units there. So you just went in reverse there.
Yeah, and it's, you know, there's a lot
of... And parking's a lot different than a parking garage, because people want to park in the same, on street level, you know.
Yeah, no, it is.
They don't want to spend every day going in and going around a corkscrew.
But there is a big resistance to understanding that not every household is going to need two cars.
Yeah.
You know? In the next 20 years, we're going to see a lot of change in that arena, and I don't want us building a building today that reflects parking from 10 years ago, you know, like I want us building a building today that reflects parking 15 years from now. So it's we got to balance those things too, and that's a huge cost.
Well, that might be the solution.
Yep.
Might be is build in Kmart, and you bring in the bike paths or even
yep.
go up level
right.
and
yep.
you know, and have an elevated bike path. So then the people want to live there
yep.
and ride their bike, you know,
yep.
to downtown.
Yep.
Because that's the problem. Everyone wants to be in downtown.
Well,
yeah.
The parking lot in front of Kmart is bigger than Kittery Forsyth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You could build an entire downtown
yeah.
for a reasonable sized community
yeah.
in that park. Now, the problem is, and we're doing this in Kittery now. I live in Kittery. We're looking at the outlet malls, and they say, I have 10-year leases with these people. How am I going to just take them out and afford to build on top of that?
Yeah.
What you're going to have to do is you're going to have to incentivize this something like this to happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're going to have to say to the owner, you know what? You don't have a parking problem anymore because we just pulled all your parking regulations. Now you can build in the out parcel up closer to the road,
mm-hmm.
okay,
mm-hmm.
and not worry about meeting parking
yeah.
requirements. That gives them the transition piece. Now how you handle that down the road
mm-hmm.
is a bigger bigger piece, but you're going to have to understand that if you want to redevelop places where it's economically feasible for the owner, you're going to have to give them that carrot. And, you know, there's a heck of a lot of parking. Kmart's empty. I mean,
yeah.
maybe something like that
there's
works.
There's a lot of parking,
no.
even like downtown. There's a ton of surface parking lots.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the things, and if you look at the parking nationally, and I'd get crucified for saying this, but from a national level perspective, Portsmouth does not have a parking problem.
Right.
Now,
right.
how do I know that? Point out to me the commercial interests that have come in here and created parking. There are no parking management companies that say,
yeah.
hey, you know what? I'm going to build
oh,
spaces here. I'm going to build a garage there.
Like
I lived for 3 years in Charlotte, North Carolina. They got a parking problem because they have people who come in and say, oh, you know what? I'm going to buy that piece of land solely for the purpose of creating parking because that's a business opportunity for me. That business opportunity does not exist in Portsmouth. That's why you don't see parking management companies coming in here and specifically buying land for the purpose of providing.
I was going to say, except for the past 6 months.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have one. Yeah.
We have one, yeah. But I mean, that's,
yeah.
you know, but if you build 600 space parking garage, that's going to change that. Now,
but boy, is that a hard perception. I mean, as
right.
I'll tell you,
oh, yeah.
it's a hard perception
but,
to change.
You know, also, I'm not sure about these companies, but if you have commercial parking in a place that's simply managing the parking required by code, that's not the same thing. So if you're out here
okay.
At
Hanover.
Yeah, well, the whole port walk, yeah. That's not commercial parking. I know they've got a commercial management company, right? It's not commercial parking because that's parking that was required by code to exist on that site. I'm talking about someone buying
okay.
an empty lot and saying, you know what? This community needs this. Like they need a grocery store or a CVS or a
yeah.
casino or whatever.
See an opportunity.
That's a business
yeah.
opportunity. That's when you know you've got a parking problem. New York City people buy lots and they provide parking.
Yeah.
So
sure.
I know it's not a popular perception, but from a national level perspective, someone looking at this, that's the issue that they see.
Let's give a huge hand. And again, I don't know what we're doing next week, but it'll
be parking.
Awesome.
It'll be warmer.
I'm starting to learn I need to avoid the ones that I'm most passionate about because they take over the conversation. So we won't be inviting the HDC anytime. But thanks for coming. If you want to fold up your chair and lean it against the fiction section, that would be great help. And have a beautiful day. It's warm enough.
Thanks, Rebecca.
Yeah.
Thanks, Nancy.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you very much. And this exists too. I mean, the West End is working well, I think. You know, with
yeah.
I mean, I'm assuming what I'm the banker. I'm assuming that everyone's going to park in as overall in the Hampton lot.
Obviously, people
are just. Yeah.
Oh, it's for a program, an app called
okay.
Open Bazaar. Have you heard of it?
No.
It's an open source eBay, so anyone can list anything, and no one can shut it down. There's no managing party like eBay to say, oh, you can't have that. So you can start your own store and sell anything you want.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's great. Check it out, Open Bazaar, it's free.
Open
yeah.
Bazaar.
Yeah.
We used to live in America. We used to live on
Hey, cool. How you doing?
Doing all right. Yourself?
I'm terrific. Great day. Really excited about this event.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you because, you know, seem like a young guy like yourself. I was trying to learn more about the housing situation.
Yeah.
I just kind of wanted to find out why you came down here and kind of what you're taking away from this presentation.
I came down here to learn what the issue is, what townspeople are concerned about. I've lived here for a year.
And what the roadblocks are for more affordable housing?
No. I mean, that was a question that I asked, but that's not why I came.
Okay.
I wanted to learn, what are the townspeople concerned about? I'm happy with the house that I'm in. I think it's affordable. I'm in the West End. I know a lot of young artist types like myself who are happy to live there and aren't struggling, but apparently there are people who want to live here that can't.
Right.
So I want to learn why. And it sounded like a big problem is there are so many rules about zoning, and I would like to see how I can help free that up. Like, if someone wants to build something, why should there be zoning at all, frankly, is my question. Like, why should there be a roadblock of someone saying, no, you can't build a house there? Why?
Right.
That would make more... I don't understand who would think they have the authority to tell someone that they can or can't do what they want with the property they've purchased outright. So, yeah. That's why I came and what I learned.
Definitely.
Yeah.
What's your name?
My name is Derek.
D-E-R-R-I-C-K. What's your last name?
I use my middle initial, which is J.
J.
And my last name is Freeman.
Freeman?
Yeah.
Perfect. Well, it was very nice to meet you.
Your name?
Alex Lacasse.
Alex, cool. Will I read your work in the Herald?
Yes, I'll be in the Herald tomorrow, see Ghost Online, probably by the end of the day.
Oh, wow, cool. All right. Yeah, I love that publication. Thanks for writing.
Of course.
And
my pleasure.
Keeping abreast of what's going on in the town. I read it almost every morning. I go to La Maison Navarre,
right,
and
awesome.
They have the paper there. You ever go?
I haven't been yet, but yeah, normally, I work the later shifts. I work either 12 to 8, 2 to 10, depending on...
At the Herald?
Yes, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so...
That's nuts. I never thought about newspaper time.
Mm-hmm.
Huh. All right. Well, you must have more work to do. I won't keep
very
you.
Nice to meet you,
Alex.
before returning to your vehicle.
Good morning. How do you do?
Good, you?
I'm terrific.
Good.
I parked in here today and I saw it was Sunday free parking for residents, so.
You got it, my friend.
Yep. How's your day going?
Great.
Excellent.
It's warm out there, man.
What are you watching, stocks?
Yeah.
Cool. Hey, what's looking good today? That something went way up.
This is the Bitcoin.
Get out. You're looking at Bitcoin? Hell yeah. I love Bitcoin. I use it every chance I get. You know they take it at street? At street. The restaurant. You can pay your bill and your tip with Bitcoin if you want to.
Really?
Yeah, I've done it. It's super cool. And there's one other place, Bikram Yoga in the Hannaford lot. They take Bitcoin for yoga classes. And there's one other that I can't think of. Do you use it?
I'm just beginning to watch it.
The Seacoast Rep, that's the other place. You can buy tickets to a show. And I've done it at all those places. You can even get a drink there, like, you know. And you can get Bitcoin there. They have a vending machine. If you want to buy some. Anyway, have a good day.